The crypto industry has a love-hate relationship with centralization. We need centralization, but we don't like it. Everything should be as decentralized as possible, but we also love fast transactions and low fees. 2022 highlighted the risk of centralization of capital with the collapse of 3AC and also FTX. But there are other centralization risks out there, and you don't have to dig deep to find them even in the most popular cryptocurrencies. Hey there, my name is Trevor with CMC, and today we'll be discussing decentralization in crypto, and we'll be showing you which areas are not as decentralized as they claim to be. Let's get started. What is centralization in crypto? Well, centralization in crypto comes from centralized points in the tech stack. Anytime there is a choke point in the infrastructure, centralization occurs. To name only a few examples, there are only a handful of internet service providers to use. Miners are concentrated due to economies of scale and hash power, meaning it's easier for bigger mining firms to be profitable. Nodes can have centralized clients or rely on centralized node hosting. Centralization can also lead to censorship, and here, censorship actually refers to the exclusion of transactions or addresses. We can distinguish between strong censorship and weak censorship. Strong censorship is the exclusion of transactions from a block, and it happens on the protocol level when miners don't process a transaction from a certain address. One example would be the Tornado Cash sanctions. The Office of Foreign Assets Control, or OFAC, sanctioned Tornado Cash in several associated Ethereum addresses in August of 2022, leading to relay operators to filter specific transactions. And weak censorship can happen at the protocol or infrastructure level. An example is DeFi frontends or infrastructure providers like Infura restricting the flow of transactions through their nodes. Of course, this happened with Infura a few months ago, sparking a discussion about the decentralization of Ethereum. So the conclusion is that more centralization opens the way for more potential censorship, but more centralization can come in many shapes and sizes. So let's talk about the different types of centralization risks. A study about blockchain decentralization by blockchain security company Trail of Bits points out different vectors of centralization risks. So we have governance, so how many entities are needed to disrupt the system. Then we have consensus, how many entities control the hashing or validation power. Then we have motivational, so how are participants incentivized to act correctly. And then we have topological, so can a few nodes be disrupted, impacting the entire network. And then we have network, so are nodes dispersed geographically and across internet service providers or ISP, and software. Does the blockchain depend on any special software? Some of these have been well-known topics for discussion for Bitcoin, Ethereum, and other chains. So for example, while consensus and governance centralization are similar, you can argue that Ethereum is exposed to an added risk vector through Vitalik. If someone disrupted Vitalik, it would throw Ethereum into turmoil, regardless of how many entities control validation power. In a way, this happened to Solana when FTX, one of the biggest backers, went under. And in similar fashion, topological centralization can harm scaling solutions and alternative layer one chains. They depend on cross-chain bridges, which can be exploited and proverbially sever the link to more liquid ecosystems. And then when we're talking about the examples of this, we have the $190 million hack of Nomad, and then we have the hack of Binance's Bridge, the $625 million hack of Ronin Bridge. And with that in mind, what kind of centralization risks do the big ecosystems face? So let's talk about decentralization risk in Ethereum. Ethereum has a fair bit of centralization risk. Take consensus centrality. At the time of this video, Lido and the top three centralized exchanges, so Binance, Coinbase, and Kraken, hold the majority of the staked ETH. While Lido technically only aggregates the delegated staking power it is assigned, the concentration of voting power in the hands of a few entities can lead to cartelization. MEV can even amplify this going forward. Speaking of MEV, this has become another point of discussion for Ethereum. In simple terms, MEV refers to the profit miners can make by prioritizing some transactions over others. So this process of front running has led to the rise of MEV boost relay companies, and these are companies providing tools that help everyone to capture a slice of extra profit from MEV. So what's the problem? Validators that use these tools outsource the decision over what transactions go into a block to the MEV boost relayers, and these companies want to be compliant with, say, a sanctions regime that can exclude certain blocks, that would be censorship. And censorship, which comes from centralization. So the share is currently declining, but the centralization risk is there. Then there are centralized choke points, validator clients, and node hosting diversity. Most of Ethereum's nodes depend on one execution client or Geth. Amazon Web Hosting Services hosts the majority of nodes, so two companies provide a majority of nodes with consensus clients. While these are not imminent or even critical risk factors, they go to show that even a nominally decentralized chain like Ethereum is not that decentralized. And you can have many nodes which are widely distributed geographically and still have centralization bottlenecks. And Gary Gensler doesn't even consider Ethereum validators to be that decentralized, which is why the SEC argues that ETH is a security. And Ethereum addressed this with an addition to its roadmap called the Scourge. So the community is aware of these potential problematic issues and is looking to resolve them. So let's talk about the centralization risk in Bitcoin. Well, Bitcoin's community prides itself on Bitcoin being the most decentralized blockchain, but there are also centralization risks in Bitcoin. The obvious one is the concentration of hash power in the proverbial hands of a few mining entities. So Antpol, which is at 30.63%, and the Foundry, USA, 19.77%, control a majority of the hash rate at the time of this video, and a third pool in F2 pool at 14.26%, and you have a comfortable majority, and a fourth in Binance Pool at 11.5%, and 75% of the hash rate is owned by four mining pools. This is not necessarily bad or an immediate risk. Bitcoin's security model aligns miners' interests with that of the network as a whole. However, not being a risk today does not mean it cannot become a risk ever. The Nakamoto coefficient measures how many entities are necessary to disrupt a blockchain system, and for Bitcoin, it's currently only at 2, since only 2 mining pools would need to be disrupted. Moreover, the Trail of Bits study found that 60% of Bitcoin traffic traverses only 3 ISPs. Bitcoin ASICs production is highly centralized, with a few players like Bitmain and MicroBT dominating the market. Since Bitcoin's value is a function of the kinetic energy that it converts via ASICs, centralization is naturally going to occur. The geographic distribution of Bitcoin mining power follows a similar pattern. 58% of the mining power in January of 2022 were located in the US, so 37%, or China at 21%, according to the Cambridge Institute for Alternative Finance. For a currency whose community would like to see it become the next world reserve currency, Bitcoin is not all that much decentralized than fiat currencies. So let's talk about centralization risk in other layer 1 chains. Other blockchains like BNB Chain and Solana have often faced the wrath of hardcore crypto supporters who accuse them of being too centralized. For instance, some have pointed out that BNB Chain has only 21 validators. However, BNB Chain developers have also stressed that decentralization is a process and not an end state that BNB claims to already have reached. Solana has had to battle with repeated outages over the last years due to its hardware-hungry blockchain. And this has led to crypto Twitter saying that Solana has open hours and a support desk that will address issues when needed. And while it is true that Solana is heavily influenced and also controlled by the Solana Foundation, in other regards, it is also more decentralized than chains like Ethereum or Bitcoin. For example, Solana's Nakamoto coefficient of 27 is much higher than that of its biggest rivals. Solana also requires no minimum stake to be a validator. Through Ethereum works around this requirement with liquid staking derivatives. It introduces the very centralization many fear. Node hosting providers are similarly decentralized as with Ethereum. On the other hand, hardware requirement is famously expensive, which has contributed to the very outages that keep plaguing the blockchain. Now let's talk about centralization risk in DeFi. So this guide wouldn't be complete without a section on centralization risks in DeFi. So one of the primary risks associated with DeFi is the potential for a single entity to gain control over a large portion of the network, be it through a majority control of the governance power or being able to unilaterally change the smart contract's power a protocol. DeFi is far less equipped to deal with these risks than crypto folks like to admit. The wormhole hack in February of 2022 is a prime example of this. A hacker was able to steal 120,000 WETH from Wormhole, a cross-chain bridge, and the hacker was able to do this because the project had a vulnerability that allowed them to gain control of the funds. But this story doesn't end there. The Wormhole hacker attempted to escape with the funds by moving them through various protocols. However, in February of 2023, Jump Crypto, so the fund that initially plugged the liquidity hole caused by the hack, was able to recover the funds. But this required a bit of centralized help. Jump Crypto was able to obtain a court order from the High Court of England and also Wales, which directed Oasis Protocol to take all necessary steps to retrieve the asset. And by necessary steps, we mean changing the multi-sig to retroactively strip the hackers of their funds. Was this an example of how centralization can be abused or used in DeFi? Only through the intervention of a centralized entity was the hacker stopped. Not very decentralized, is it? Centralization risks in blockchains are real. Hosting providers and internet service providers are common bottlenecks for almost all blockchains. The concentration of capital and or hardware inevitably leads to centralization, but it's also important to keep in mind that centralization in itself isn't bad. As long as stakeholders in blockchain ecosystems work towards developing and improving the chain, centralization can even lead to efficiency gains. Crypto supporters just need to be mindful of how to mitigate the side effects of centralization.